All right, so now that we know kind of what metals are, let's start talking about purchasing metals for a particular purpose. You can't just go to the periodic table and order, aluminum from the table. In fact, it's hard to actually order something like commercially pure aluminum. It's much more likely that you would buy some kind of an alloy of aluminum. All right, we'll talk about how to specify particular alloy that you're looking for. But first, what is an alloy? Okay, so an alloy is when you take an element like a metallic element like iron or aluminum or copper, for instance, and you mix with it other types of elements. Those elements can be metals or non-metals. So for instance, we can alloy together zinc and copper and get a type of brass, or we can alloy together tin and copper and get bronze. We can also alloy with iron, carbon, and wind up with steel or even cast iron. We'll talk about that. So why would we do this? I think I've already kind of said it, but this is a nice image of this. Okay, so this is a copper nickel alloy. And you can see down here at the bottom, they're indicating what the composition is. And it's important that you understand this because we're going to come back to this in a little bit when we talk about phase diagrams. But this is copper and nickel, and it's showing along this axis what percentage of the combination is nickel. So over here on this side, we have 0% nickel, and on this side, we have 100% nickel. So this is pure nickel. On the right side, let me get this pointer. This is the pure nickel side, and on this side is the pure copper. A lot of times it'll just say this is copper and tin, and they'll or copper and nickel, and they'll have a just one of those elements will be listed down here. That's why I've grayed out the copper down here. And this is also by weight percent, so that makes it real easy to actually do this. In a facility, you can weigh out 10 pounds of nickel and 10 pounds of copper and get a nice 50-50 ratio. The other axis over here is tensile strength, and here we've listed it in megapascals, but it could be any units. You'd have the same shape, say graph, and you can see that the tensile strength maxes out here somewhere toward the middle. And easy way to say this is that an alloy of nickel and copper is going to be stronger than either nickel or copper. And I should say a specific alloy. This about 60% maybe nickel is stronger than either one. We have over here some very copper-rich alloys that are a little bit less strong than pure nickel. But it's very easy to come up with a combination that has more strength than either pure copper or pure nickel alone. Now, let me show you the flip side of this that I don't really have the graph, but I'll show you what happened. And this is going to be, you'll see this happen over and over again when you heat treat things and make them give them more strength. So as we give that particular alloy more strength, that's going to be raising up our yield strength, and our ultimate strength is going to go up like this. Typically, this Young's modulus is not going to change, but what we're going to give up is going to be something over here on this side. Okay, so our ultimate strength will be higher, our yield strength will be higher, but what we tend to give up is this. Do you remember what this is? When we lose things in this axis, we're losing ductility. We're losing that ability for this material to flow and stretch under tension. And sometimes we can get rid of that altogether. Sometimes we lose all of our ductility. We wind up with more strength, but we lose that ductility, and we have a brittle material that can't deform plastically like this. So that's the typical flip side of something like this. We're going to gain tensile strength, but we're probably going to lose some ductility or elongation, as it's sometimes quantified. Now, I said part of our goal for this particular unit is to learn how to buy the metal that you want, how to specify the metal that is going to meet the needs of your design. So there are different ways of buying metals, and different ways make different sense, make more sense, better sense, depending on really the quantity that you're going to buy. So if you're going to buy a large quantity of metal, you would not buy from somebody like Speedy Metals or Online Metals. But if you need just, if you need like a 2 foot stick of some, a structural steel shape, then sometimes it makes sense to pay the extra sort of premium, to have somebody cut that piece of metal and ship it to you. If you just need a little bit of a specific metal, sometimes these make good sense. Sort of a good middle ground is like a steel supplier, distributor. Somebody like Southern Steel here in Memphis is a good place to go to get sort of medium quantities of steel. And that's, you know, like thousands of pounds, you know, a few hundred to thousands of pounds of steel. If you need a few sticks of steel, a lot of structural steel comes in a 20-foot stick. And so if you need, you know, a few sticks of that, I think they have like a minimum purchase of like $50, something like that. But it's going to be much more economical if you need, a 12, 13 feet of something to buy from someone like Southern Steel than to buy from someone like Speedy Metals. If, on the other hand, you need, say, millions of pounds of steel or aluminum per year, you're going to buy from somebody that's actually producing those materials, like Hydro Aluminum or Kaiser Aluminum, would be somebody that you would buy if you're making like if you're making soda cans or air conditioning components and things. If you're making automotive parts, you'll be buying from a manufacturer. But whatever it is that you're going to buy, there are ways of specifying these materials so that you get exactly what you need, and it's going to do the job that it's intended to do. So one of the most important standards publishing organizations is ASTM, the American Society for Testing and Manufacturing, or Testing and Materials. There will have standards on, you know, for everything beyond just metals. I mean, there's all kinds of things that have ASTM standards. You may find a marker that has an ASTM standard on it for toxicity or something like that. So tons and tons of ASTM standards. If you go over to our library, you can find these printed out, and it's like the New York phone book, a phone directory. It's just volumes and volumes and volumes. Very important information in these standards. With regard to purchasing metals, two of the big things that you'll get from an ASTM standard in general are the tensile strength, the strength of the material, the tensile strength and the yield strength, and the ductility. So you'll have a percent ductility, and then it will tell you what the minimum and sometimes the maximum tensile strength is. And also the chemical composition. What is, if you're going to call your aluminum 6061, T6511, what is going to actually be present in that particular aluminum? So be familiar with ASTM standards. I put a link, I uploaded a ASTM standard to your to the e-courseware. You'll need to be familiar with that, and then when you take the quiz, go ahead and get familiar with it first of all, and then you will see that you'll need to be able to read and interpret that standard for the quiz. Also, if you're at University of Memphis, you should know that you have access to the entire ASTM collection. So you've got, you can go out, I'll put a link on the website, but you can go out and get the entire ASTM collection. For any standard that's an ASTM standard, you have access to full text. Now, there are two main groups of metals that we'll talk about, and these are ferrous and non-ferrous metals. All right, I'm pretty sure you know where the ferrous comes from, and that's the Latin for iron is ferrum, okay? And so the symbol, the atomic symbol that we use for iron today is Fe, and so if it's a ferrous metal, it's predominantly iron-based, and so it has at least 50% iron for its quantity or composition. Non-ferrous metals have less than that much iron in them, so they're predominantly some other alloy. All right, so these are the main ferrous metals. This is probably most of them. Maybe one on here that, or some that I have forgotten, but most common is steel. So steel is iron, elemental iron, and some amount of carbon. So generally a little bit of carbon, up to about 2%. Once you get past 2% carbon, you start getting into the realm of what are called cast irons. So these, we start to lose a lot of ductility and malleability of the material. You'll see some iron named ductile iron and malleable iron because they have some limited ductility and malleability added back in. But in general, you lose that when you move to cast irons. So cast iron, you start with pure iron, add some carbon, get steel, add more carbon, and get cast irons. Then there are, let's see, so we said the steels, there are, you add just iron and carbon, and you have a carbon steel. If you start adding other alloys like molybdenum and chromium, you wind up in the realm of alloy steels. And then tool steels are alloy steels that are designed for a specific purpose. Generally, those purposes are useful for tooling. When I say tooling, I'm talking about dies and molds and you know, forging dies and punches, things like that, not really hand tools. And then there are stainless steels, and you get stainless steel when you add enough chromium. So once you get to the about 11% chromium, you enter the world of stainless steels. Now, when you're buying steel, there are different ways to specify steel. One sort of catch-all way is to use SAE. This is the AISI/SAE numbering system. This is Society of Automotive Engineers, and sometimes you'll see the AISI, which is the American Iron Steel Institute. This designation actually tells you a pretty good bit about the steel that you're interested in, and you can specify a steel based on this code. So a 1000 series steel is a carbon steel. A 2000 series is a nickel steel. We'll see down here molybdenum steels in the 4000 series. So the main alloying group is the first digit. And then the second two digits together are the amount of carbon. Now this is not 18%. Remember that we said that if we have more than 2%, we're not even dealing with steel anymore. We're dealing with cast iron. So this is 0.18%, not 18%, but it's 0.18% carbon. So this tells us the carbon content and the major alloy group. So it was sort of encoded in there. You can also buy steels by specifying their particular ASTM designation. For instance, ASTM A36 is a pretty common structural steel. But this is a carbon steel. Like we said, this is the most generic steel that can be called a steel. It really only needs to have iron and carbon to make it into this category. And when you start adding very much of anything else, then it will become an alloy steel. For instance, a chromoly steel is a pretty famous alloy steel. So it's got chromium and molybdenum in it. A classic example is AISI SAE 4130. Then there are the tool steels, like I said, and these are grouped by sort of their characteristics, okay? Sometimes by how they're hardenable. For instance, A is an air hardening tool steel. O is an oil hardening tool steel. And this letter is followed typically by a number, okay? So you have an A2 or a D2 tool steel or O1 tool steel. In fact, we use O1 tool steel in the tool design class because it's a nice, inexpensive, real easy to work with, real easy to heat treat tool steel. You also have like shock resisting tool steels. So sometimes you talk about the letter has to do with the characteristics. So a very tough shock-resisting tool steel is an S7. So we've got a bunch of S7 down in the shop. So these are the tool steels. They are specialized tool steels for unique demands of tooling. Now steel is available in a variety of shapes. Now not all steel is available in all of these shapes. But carbon steel, plain carbon steel, pretty much available in any of these shapes that you see here. I would like to point out, if you are reading this and you see W shapes and M shapes and S shapes, you might be thinking to yourself, well, I don't see anything that looks like an M or a W or an S over here. And that's because this is an S shape. Okay, this first I-beam shape is an S shape, and it stands for structural, standard structural steel. So it's a standard shape. This is a standard I-beam. This is what would be called an S shape. You may also see this. This is, looks like an I-beam as well. This could be an M shape or a W shape or an HP. So if it's a W, that's a wide flange beam. So these have wider flanges than the S shapes do. The M shapes have a sort of an identical look, but they have, if it's an M shape, it's a miscellaneous shape, and it doesn't fit the standard wide flange beam shapes. HP shapes also look the same. These are pilings. They're for structural pilings that you drive down into the ground. Now you can have T shapes that are cut from M shapes or W shapes, and you can also have L shapes or angle. Okay, so angles are pretty common. You know, a lot of people call this angle iron, even though it's typically steel. You can also have tube and pipe. This is an example of a piece of tube, and this, depending on the dimensions, could be a piece of tube or a piece of pipe. It looks like it's really hard to tell without some numbers on there. Then you can have round bar, you can have square bars, you can have plates, and when it gets thinner than a quarter of an inch, you call it sheet. So you can have sheet metal, or you can have plates. You can also have billets and blooms, which are actually what these shapes tend to be rolled out of. So I left them off because these are the shapes that you're typically going to be buying. All right, we said stainless steel is what you start getting when you add more than 11%, or you start getting to the realm of 11% chromium. There are different designations for stainless steel, but you'll see if you read anything about them, they're going to start talking about austenitic, ferritic, martensitic, precipitation hardening, and duplex, which is austenitic and ferritic, a combination. Well, very shortly, we're going to start talking about steels, and we'll know what austenite is and what ferrite is and what martensite is, and this might make a little bit more sense at that point. So for now, just recognize that these terms are referring to stainless steels, and we'll talk more about the details of what those things mean in coming lectures. This is a great look at how these different types of steels break down. And I'll probably maybe revisit this slide later on when we see that we have austenitic stainless steel up here. And this is at room temperature. And later on we'll see that that's unusual and we'll see why. But this is what makes how the stainless steels break down. Like we said, we have to start adding chromium, and we don't even get any stainless steel until we get up here to 11% chromium. So everything on here is greater than 11% chromium. And then the other axis of this is nickel. So as you start adding nickel, we'll see later on that it stabilizes the austenite, and that's what allows you to have this weird structure austenite at room temperature, is all this nickel that's in here. And you also see we have some overlap between martensitic steel and ferritic steels. And the difference here is we start adding some chromium. We start adding carbon. We don't have a carbon axis on this diagram, but that's where the distinction between these two is most visible, is the amount of carbon that's added. All right, so that's all we're going to say about ferrous metals right now, but we'll go ahead and talk a little bit about non-ferrous metals, and then we'll come back, and when we talk about we'll talk more about ferrous metals when we talk about the iron-carbon system. Now, these are not all of the non-ferrous metals, aluminum, copper, magnesium, titanium, tin, zinc, and lead, but these are the most popular ones. For aluminum, aluminum has a numbering system that's similar to the one that's the Iron and Steel Institute and the SAE for steel. And it comes from an ANSI standard. ANSI is another standard organization, sort of like ASTM. But they define this numbering system for aluminum. And it consists of two parts. Okay, so our, come back. The first part of this is the alloy. So 6061 will tell you what elements are going into this steel. The second part of this is the temper designation. That tells us how the steel was or was not heat treated. I should mention also, this should be on a separate slide, But there is this thing called the UNS. And so all of these numbers that we're talking about, all of these codes, whether it's for the stainless steel or for the carbon steel or the tool steel, there is an equivalent UNS number associated with those. And this is used mostly with international trade. It's not so popular in the United States. Generally, if you want 1018, you ask for 1018, or if you want 6061, you just ask for that. But for international trade, the UNS makes it much easier to be able to convert from one country's standards to another's. All right, so let's see. Here's an example of a pretty common aluminum alloy, and that is 6061. You can see it actually printed on the bar here. This is the alloy. This tells us how much of the different alloying elements go into this particular aluminum. Let me just pause. And in fact, you can see we can go out and we can get the ASTM B221 standard, and we can look up alloy 6061, and we can see on there how much silicon, what are the silicon limits. It can have between 0.4 and 0.8% silicon, how much iron can go into it, how much copper should be there, how much manganese should be there, how much magnesium, chromium, and the rest. So this tells you these are the chemical composition limits for 6061T6. Now, notice it's not telling us how strong that 6061 is. And that's because it depends on the heat treatment. How that 6061 gets treated after it's made and extruded, that will affect the strength. So we can come down here to table 2, the mechanical property limits, and we can see that for a particular alloy, here we'll just look at the ones up at the top, for alloy 1060, if it's got an O temper, that is an annealed temper, that is the softest state of that aluminum, it has a tensile strength of 8.5 KSI. All right, and we don't see a whole lot of increase when we go from one to the other there, but let's drop down to alloy 214. You can see here's the O temper. It has a max tensile strength of 30 KSI. And of course, that's thousands of pounds per square inch. Now, you might think that's weird to have a maximum tensile strength, and notice the rest of these have a minimum tensile strength. That's because if you're using O temper, what you're most interested in is the ductility of that material. You want to be able to form that into various shapes, and so it will have a max tensile strength. The other ones, you can see, we can look at this. We can go from this variety of aluminum, alloy 1060, to alloy 214 with a T62 temper. We can go from, or really a T6511 temper, we can go from 8.5 KSI to 68. Okay, so we can have a huge difference in tensile strengths. This is a higher tensile strength than some steels, by the way. So a huge variety there. All right, so it's not enough just to order or to ask for a certain alloy. The temper designation has to go along with that. All right, so here are some of the temper designations. We talked about annealed. That's the softest state of the aluminum, and there are others. Okay, so some of these will take a number after them. The O does not, the F does not, but the H's do, the T's do, and they tell you how specifically that material was treated, and that aluminum in particular. So this is the actual alloy and temper of the bar stock that we'll use in the lab. It is 6061 T6511, 1-inch diameter rod, and it conforms to the chemistry that's specified in ASTM B221. And actually, this does point to the dimensional tolerance limits for this bar stock. It also has some things to say about how it should be marked and how it should be packaged, and who has the responsibility for testing and confirming that it conforms to these standards. All of that is spelled out in this standard. So part of your assignment for your quiz is you're going to have to pull some information out of that standard. So I really want you to be familiar with the ASTM standards. What happens if I go out and sell some aluminum And somebody asked me for 6061. I go out with a magic marker and I write 6061 T6511 on it, and it's not really that material. Well, you can go to jail, okay, because that becomes a criminal offense. In fact, there was a really, really astounding lawsuit just recently about some people that were selling, not to just anybody, but they were fabricating test results for some aluminum and selling it to NASA, which actually resulted in the loss of some space missions, some satellite launches. So really a phenomenal sort of a sensational lawsuit against people for saying that something conformed to ASTM standards when it in fact did not. So I would encourage you to go out and look at that. That's a pretty recent happening there. Also, another common alloy is, or copper alloys. Okay, so you can use commercially pure copper. It's used pretty frequently. It's used a lot more than commercially pure aluminum. So more or less commercially pure copper is used in a lot of plumbing applications. It's used in electrical applications. And like I said earlier, you can combine copper with something like zinc and get a series of brass products. Copper and tin, these are bronze alloys. And it's actually a little bit more complicated than that, but not too much more. But this is what we need to know for the test. Is brass is copper zinc, bronze is copper tin. This is a lot more accurate to say than the brass definition, but it's fine. We're going to go with that. We're using alloy 360 brass in the lab, if you're interested in looking that up. Then there are also copper nickels and nickel silvers that are actually a copper alloy as well. These get a little bit more expensive. You get into things like naval brass that are really, really good at corrosion resistance. But copper, so a couple of things you might not recognize about copper, because you typically deal with small quantities of it, unless you're carrying wire. And if you've ever worked for an electrician, you probably already know this, but copper is actually a very heavy metal. It's heavier than steel, so copper is heavy and also has a very high melting point. So two things that are not commonly known about copper. Magnesium, at the other end of the spectrum, has really very lightweight material, and it'll catch on fire if you get it too hot. So it will actually combust if it gets if you get it started burning. Just an ingot of magnesium can be lit on fire with a really, really brilliant white flame. But one of it's the reason you would use magnesium is if you needed a very lightweight metal that had good strength to weight characteristics, but was overall a very, very not dense, a very light metal. Titanium, a really interesting metal, used locally an awful lot in Memphis because we have a lot of that biomedical device manufacturing going on here. So a lot of spinal implants and hip implants and knee implants are made in Memphis. And so a lot of titanium goes through this city. And it's got some pretty interesting characteristics. You know, number one, it's nice and biocompatible, but it is strong, lightweight, and hard. And if I handed you a piece of titanium, if I hand you a really big chunk, and I've got some really big chunks, it's not really impressively light until you realize that it's about half as dense as steel, but really just as strong as steel. And so that's what's amazing. And when you really see that when you have a small, thin piece of titanium and you try to bend it. So very strong, lightweight, and biocompatible. Oh, you can also do this neat thing. This is really a processes two thing, but you can take a piece of titanium and if you put it in an electrolyte and pass a current through it, you can actually anodize the surface of the titanium. We talked about anodizing when we talked about aluminum. When you anodize aluminum, you actually dye it and you trap the dye in the surface. But when you anodize titanium, these colors come about naturally by the thickness of the coating that you grow on the titanium. And that's simply proportional to the voltage that you apply to it. So apply a DC voltage across here and you can grow an oxide layer on here that will go through an amazing series of colors. Then I'll just mention tin. I don't have too much to say about tin. Used a lot in solder, however, and we'll talk a little bit more about tin in particular later on. Zinc used a whole lot in two main categories, two uses. One is to galvanize steel, so it's used as a coating on steel, and it's also used as a metal for die casting. A lot of times you hear people talk about pot metal. A lot of times what they're actually talking about is zinc. So die casting, a lot of die cast stuff is zinc. It gets mistaken for aluminum sometimes, but if you have a die cast Hot Wheels cars and things, they tend to be made out of zinc. And then lead, important because of its use in lead acid batteries, is still a huge use of lead. We've seen less use of lead in like lead oxides and paints because of all of the terrible stuff surrounding lead paint and the poisonous, toxic lead paint. But it's also used in things like flashing, for house flashing, where it's not going to be, it's up on the outside on your roof, where it's not going to be nibbled on by children. It's also used in shielding for radiation, things like that. Still used in solder in the United States, much less so in European countries. I'm not sure that it's allowed at all over there. We, of course, still use it in ammunition, but less so nowadays. Some shot is being replaced by things like steel shot and what else have they got, tungsten shots, stuff like that. And there you go. All right, so last of all, we'll talk about tungsten, which is ridiculously dense. I've got a nice chunk of tungsten that when we have class in person, I like to pass around. What I like to pass around is a piece of magnesium, first of all, and get you all lulled into this really lightweight, very not dense magnesium. And then you hold a piece of tungsten, and it's just ridiculously dense. Besides being dense and cool, it's used in welding electrodes. So we'll use some tungsten later in the semester, I certainly hope. To do TIG welding, that's tungsten inert gas welding. So you'll see relatively pure tungsten used for that. And then second of all, tungsten carbide is sort of the preeminent cutting tool material. It is certainly the most common cutting for metal cutting material out there. And we'll see why it's so great at that. A spoiler alert, it's because it has really good hardness and really good toughness characteristics. All right, so that's the intro to commercially important metals, and that's all I got to say about that.